History and Freedom by Theodor Adorno, Lecture 28, and this is the last one, Moral Uncertainties, February 25th, 1965. Last time we talked about how to differentiate the will from the definition of pure reason, not from the standpoint of the will, but from that of reason. Perhaps you will recall that I pointed out that the specificities of pure logic, which in general are those of reason, are also in reality the sedimented specificities of the will, which admittedly disappear in it. I mention then, and I would like to remind those of you who wish to go more deeply into this question, that I have found it necessary to make a major correction to what I wrote in the chapter on the critique of logical absolutism in Against Epistemology, since what I wrote there was too one-sided and could even be misunderstood as a relapse into a psychologistic approach to logic. Those of you who are familiar with the tenor of the book will know that this was not my intention, nor could it ever be. Nevertheless, I think it worth mentioning at this point. In Against Epistemology, I had placed great emphasis upon the genetic aspect in so-called formal logic, and hence ultimately upon its relation to existing reality, and brought out this aspect very strongly through what I hope were convincing analyses. But in the course of my argument, I neglected the Hegelian element that constantly recurs in Hegel under the heading of disappearance. In this instance, this refers to the idea that, despite its dependence on the genetic elements I've referred to, logic possesses an objective validity. And this is something Hegel really did understand very clearly. What this means is that these genetic elements, in other words, the elements related to particular aspects of being, disappear in the context of the validity of logic. Thus, logic is both absolute and something that has developed, that has arisen, precisely by virtue of the objective process of reification that I described in my book, a process that was not merely something negative, a forgetting, but one that also formed the constitution of an objective region, as Husserl's logic would call it. We might go so far here as to speculate whether the absolute separation of genesis and validity that I retained even while criticizing it is not itself a false distinction, a pseudos. Perhaps we have accustomed ourselves, under the influence above all of Husserl and Scheller, to think of validity and genesis as absolutely distinct, as a chorus, and in the process have fallen victim to a false consciousness. And perhaps once we admit that these two elements are not mutually exclusive and irreconcilable, we shall be able to see how a mediation may be brought about between objective validity, objective ontological validity, if I may call it that, and an ontic state of having developed a genesis. You may say, if I may continue for a moment, with this speculative line of thought, that even though the system of logic is a realm free of contradiction, it nevertheless contains a profound contradiction, by which it is in a sense enchanted, and which cannot be resolved by recourse to logic itself. To put it in a nutshell, this contradiction is the fact that logic both is and is not a historical product. This will perhaps enable you to see that dialectics is not simply an additional factor to be superimposed on traditional logic, but something that penetrates to and is encapsulated in the innermost cells of pure logic itself. We might say that Schopenhauer was a thoroughgoing idealist in the sense that reason itself is what he called the negation of the will to life, or at any rate, reason is also that. In other words, reason is a reification, albeit one in the service of the so-called will to life. There's a real conflict here. Its theme is the age-old, constantly recurring problem of killing yourself in order to survive. The problem of imitation, of making oneself resemble something, of mimesis, a problem that has taken on a peculiar force in our own phase of history. But the situation that I am describing is inverted for the idealist. It is turned upside down, because without will, there is no consciousness. The idealist view is that will is much the same thing as consciousness. Nevertheless, if I may repeat the decisive point, The will is to be found in thinking. It is its active component. If I am to reflect, I have to wish to do so. In order to reflect, I have to want to reflect. Otherwise, in the absence of this element of will, even the simplest act of thought is inconceivable. The purely contemplative, thinking, judging act, the intentional act of consciousness in the broadest sense, always contains this element of will. Something that is only denied or conjured away by intellectualizing theories of knowledge after the fact. But as an activity, consciousness is never pure, as the philosophers fondly believe, but is always actual behavior. It is an ontic reality, or to put it provocatively, it is always a material reality. Hence, just as I maintained earlier on in connection with the concept of logical reason, albeit very briefly, this concept of the will can only be grasped dialectically, namely as the power of consciousness through which consciousness breaks out of its own bounds and out of what existed already, mere being. But we should likewise be wary of hypostatizing this more narrowly voluntaristic notion of will. After what I have said, it should no more be hypostatized than should the intellectual dimension. If the will were nothing but what I have called the additional factor, if it were no more than an impulse, as the so-called decisionist theories teach, then the will would be at the disposition of every conceivable purpose, just as much as instrumental reason is according to the analysis with which you are familiar. As long as the two aspects remain entirely separate from one another, they tend to converge by virtue of the fact that they become available in a quite arbitrary way, and precisely this random availability is incompatible with the idea of the will. The memory of the irrational aspect of the will, incidentally, has always been the companion of idealism, for example in the statement by Fichte that I've referred to several times to the effect that morality is self-evident, and that therefore thinking is not really necessary as guide to moral behavior. Of course, if morality is self-evident, and if therefore the human subject is exempted from the need to make judgments about what he has to do, this obviously already implies that the will is irrational. This remains true regardless of the extent to which Kantian and Fichtean ethics may have thought of themselves as rational. However, the idea that the will, or more generally morality, is self-evident is one we cannot avoid criticizing. The self-evident nature of morality, the dispensation of morality from rational critical reflection, belongs to the unenlightened residue of all the things that are self-evident, because we simply accept them without reflecting on them critically. It is the refuge of repression. This truth extends into the heart of moral philosophy. The one, the identical, the immutable, is supposed to be the good according to Plato, and especially all more recent moral philosophers. Whatever refuses to dissolve into this unity, this identity, this immutable condition, is declared to be the legacy of nature and hence of evil. It can be said that just as the old nature gods were turned into the embodiments of evil by Christianity, and the popular outlook associated with it into demons and devils, a comparable process took place in the sublime sphere of metaphysics. By this, I mean that where nature was not completely tamed by the single unifying principle, it was denigrated. The aspects of nature that were not mastered or shaped were equated without more ado with evil and the demonic. The things that are regarded by traditional bourgeois morality as evil are in reality the post-existence of older forces that had been partly, but not entirely, subjugated and that subsequently returned. If we reflect on this for a moment, we will have to confess that this process of denigration is not entirely without justification, because when nature is repressed and then returns in that repressed shape, it assumes the destructive features that at least provide us with a powerful pretext for identifying them with the evil principle. If you read Freud's essay, Civilization and Its Discontents, with this in mind, you will see Freud as a late representative of Enlightenment, who in this respect finds himself in complete agreement with the modern philosophical tradition of the West, but who nevertheless demonizes nature, with which returns, or that which returns, condemning it as destructive. At the same time, you will find a highly rational explanation of why nature actually is evil and demonic, an idea of the good that is meant to inform the will, but into which the concrete specificities and mediations of reason do not fully enter because they are supposed to be taken for granted, ends up simply submitting to the reified consciousness, ossified conditions, and whatever is socially approved. Hegel actually took this step when he equated self-evident morality with the substance of society, or the nation, that is, with whatever was found to be already established in a community. In line with this, he condemned as mere caprice any critical scrutiny of such an established order. By emancipating itself from the specificities of reason, will in itself, without any further specification, necessarily includes the domination of nature in its archaic, primitive form, namely the rule of force, direct, naked force. It can be said that pure will is not merely the readiness to do good, it is also the readiness to do evil, an extreme reversal of the celebrated dictum on the opening page of Kant's groundwork of the Metaphysic of Morals. It is not by accident that the National Socialists called one of their frenzied party congresses the Triumph of the Will. Without its being indicated in this case, what this will was for or what it was supposed to achieve. And in general, it could be shown in great detail that fascist irrationalism almost always involves breaking off the process of reflection. So the message conveyed is something like, live dangerously, as Nietzsche put it. This watchword may indeed contain a core of truth, for example, if what is wanted is that we should accept risk in order to bring about conditions that are more worthy of human beings. But as soon as danger or sacrifice become ends in themselves, the injunction becomes a thing of evil. This fetishization, this exaltation into absolute norms or values, of ideas that only become meaningful if they result from a process of reflection, ideas such as sacrifice or make yourselves free, or the ideas of the triumph of the will or live dangerously that I have just referred to, this fetishization is the key, the signature of the modern form of rationalism. What distinguishes it is the fact that it is, in a sense, infected by reason while denying its influence. However, if in fact and in contrast to the irrationalist undercurrent that casts its shadow over the entire history of Western rationalism, a substantial, indubitable certainty with regard to moral behavior does not exist, then it follows that there is no such thing as moral certainty or self-evident morality or direct moral self-certainty. We might almost say that to suggest that we could ever know beyond doubt and unproblematically what is good would be the beginning of all evil. You are all familiar with the statements in the New Testament attacking the Pharisees. These criticisms all make clear that the positive and unproblematic assumption of the good, independently of that risk, independently of the extremely serious and concrete possibility that even where you do Kant's bidding and act in accordance with the pure will, these criticisms mean that you will have reached the point where you are likely to do bad and even catastrophic things. And those passages in the New Testament provide us with the most succinct expression of this. This fallibility is an essential characteristic of all moral action, all acts that intend the good in an emphatic sense. The entire moral sphere has its serious aspect, the dimension that raises it above the level of Sunday sermons and cheap words of comfort, in the fact that at the very point where we feel certain that we are doing the right thing and are acting in good faith, we often end up behaving quite wrongly. This leads to the consequence that the most extreme mental efforts are called for if we are ever to enter the sphere in which it may be proper to speak of the good. However, the more society develops into an overpowering, objectively conflict-ridden totality, the less will and any individual moral decision have claims to be judged authentic and right. We could put this a different way, and I am not deterred from doing so by the possible accusation that I am depriving you of something or that I am undermining your sense of moral certainty. The fact is that I believe that this sense of certainty should be undermined and that moral consciousness only begins at the point where certainty is not thought to be self-evident. Thus, we are all ensnared by the false totality, whatever we do. We are all afflicted by the false catastrophic totality. I once ventured to write that there can be no good life within the bad one, an idea I found later on in Nietzsche, though I can no longer recollect the passage. This idea applies not just to happiness or to a good life in an aesthetic sense or something of the sort. It must be applied strictly to the idea of the good itself. You need only attempt to do something with the existing order of things, something you feel would be the decent thing to do, and you will soon find yourselves caught up in a dialectic without end, one in which the good you are trying to achieve has to be paid for with infinite quantities of the bad and the dubious, with injustice, unkindness, and forgetting. But if we were then to conclude, as do some moral philosophers, that the most moral course of action would be simply to sit back and do nothing, we should be no better off. For that would be simply to leave the dubious totality in place, to allow it to wreak what damage it will, and thus to submit to it. Kant's disapproval of psychology is grounded in his desire to salvage an ontological authority which I have referred to several times. This disapproval also contains the authentic insight that the so-called moral categories of the individual are more than strictly individual. I believe that it is important to point this out now, towards the very end of these lectures, when I wish to concretize my thesis of the essentially conflict-ridden nature of the moral. I wish to make sure that I am not misunderstood here. On the one hand, our task must be to carry out the critique of the moral as the bad universal in its repression of the individual, and to pursue this in an uncompromising way. On the other hand, however, it is no less impossible to conceive of a moral system without a universal dimension with which to set bounds to the unreflecting being for self of the individual. The concept of mankind, which, as you know, plays such a crucial role in Kant's moral philosophy, contains the idea of reason as a universally valid notion in the sense that it is applicable to all rational beings. That is, it applies to society as a whole. We might say, then, that universality in the moral realm points to the plurality of subjects and thus, in the final analysis, to society. In this respect, Kant's moral philosophy converges surprisingly, even paradoxically, if you like, with its chosen adversary, namely psychology. For psychology teaches that what Kant thinks of as the supreme moral authority, namely conscience, which in the language of psychology is the superego, is nothing but the internalized social norm. With this idea that the conscience, the superego, which is the decisive layer of individuality or of the monad, actually contains the whole of society, that it is the agent of society in each individual, with this idea psychology breaks through its own monadological limits. The superego, the conscience, contains an undifferentiated amalgam consisting on the one hand of mere heteronomous coercion, and on the other of the idea of a human solidarity that transcends all individual interests. The norm that we have criticized as repressive always testifies to the aspects of society that point beyond particularity, even while particularity remains the principle of society. The only problem is that in the here and now, this norm is incompatible with the justified and legitimate interests of the individual. This is the source of what is wrong with the concept of the superego. Thus, conscience is inhabited by both right and wrong, and the power of solidarity of which I have just spoken can grow only by working its way through its own repressive nature. Perhaps I may be allowed at this point to read out to you a few sentences from a text on moral philosophy on which these lectures have in large measure been based. I do so simply because time is so short and because they sum up succinctly the ideas that I have been telling you about. The question of right and wrong in matters of conscience cannot be answered definitively, because right and wrong are part of conscience itself and cannot be separated by any abstract judgment. As I have just said, the spirit of solidarity is only able to develop on the back of the spirit of repression, which that of solidarity then annuls. The fact that the gulf between individual and society is so small, but equally that the two are never reconciled, is essential to moral philosophy. To this day, the bad side of universality protests against the socially unfulfilled claims of the individual. That is the supra-individual element of truth in the critique of morality. But the individual whom need has made guilty, and who has come to be his own be-all and end-all, falls victim to the delusion of an individualistic society, and thus fails to know himself. a consequence which Hegel perceived and perceived most acutely at the very moment when he was colluding in reactionary abuse. Society is in the wrong vis-a-vis the individual and its universal claims, but it is also in the right since the individual hypostasizes the social principle of pure, unreflecting self-preservation, the very principle embodying the bad universal. The late statement by Kant that the freedom of each human being need be curtailed only insofar as it restricts someone else's freedom encodes a reconciled condition that rises above not just the bad universal, the course of machinery of society, but also the obdurate individual who is a copy in miniature of that machinery. The question of freedom does not call for a simple yes or no, but a theory that rises above society, as well as above the individual existing in it. Instead of applying sanctions to the internalized and entrenched authority of the superego, the task of theory should be to make transparent the dialectic of individual and species, a task to which I have devoted these observations on the philosophy of history. The unyielding harshness of the superego is no more than a reaction to the fact that such transparency is impossible as long as conditions full of conflict persist. The human subject could be liberated only where it had achieved reconciliation. This would place it above freedom, which, as privilege, the inheritance of the feudal lord, primarily involved taking for oneself, and hence nobility. As such, it is in league with its opposite. Repression. The presence of aggression and freedom becomes visible whenever, in the midst of unfreedom, human beings practice the gestures of freedom. In a state of freedom, the individual would not be too concerned with preserving his old particularity. Individuality is both the product of pressure and the focal point of resistance to it, but neither would that freedom be able to acquiesce in the current conception of collectivity. The fact that, in the countries that monopolize the name of socialism, collectivism is recommended and even prescribed in the shape of subordination of the individual to the collective, gives the lie to their socialism and consolidates the presence of conflict, antagonism. Infected by an irrational cult of community, the term alienation has recently become fashionable in both East and West, thanks to the veneration of the young Marx and the expense of the old one, and thanks to the regression of the objective dialectics to anthropology. This term alienation takes an ambivalent view of a repressive society. It is as ambivalent as genuine suffering under the rule of alienation itself. The self is weakened by a socialized society that tirelessly drives people together and renders them both literally and figuratively incapable of solitude. This weakening of the self manifests itself in complaints about isolation, and also in the truly unbearable coldness spread over all things human by the expanding exchange relation. The idea that a union of free human beings should find it necessary constantly to flock together belongs to the mental world of parades, marches, flag waving, and the ceremonial speeches of political leaders of whatever hue. Such methods are needed only as long as society seeks irrationally to cement relations between its members, who have no choice but to belong. Collectivism and individualism join forces to bring about a false state of affairs. Tout cela sera balayé. As André Gide has remarked, unless the cyclical return of the bad triumphs after all. Well, ladies and gentlemen, despite all that, there is a genuine possibility of freedom even in a totality steeped in guilt. Again and again, human subjects feel intermittently that they are potentially free, even though unfree in reality. And in tune with our discussions up to now, you see that I am trying to keep my promise not to begin with definitions, but to end with them. We may say that an action is free if it is related transparently to the freedom of society as a whole. By way of conclusion, and in a desperate attempt to save time, I should like to read out to you one or two more sentences from something I have written. Human subjects are free on the Kantian model, insofar as they are conscious of and identical with themselves. But then again, they are unfree in this identity insofar as it acts as a form of coercion to which they submit. Again, they are unfree as non-identical beings, as diffuse nature, and yet as such they are free, after all, because the impulses that overpower them, and that is what non-identity amounts to, rid them of the coercive character of identity. Personality is the caricature of freedom. The basis for the aporia is that truth beyond coercive identity would not be its absolute other, but would always pass through that coercive identity and be mediated by it. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to an end. I am fully conscious, as I have already mentioned, of the fragmentary nature of what I have been saying, although I have at least made the attempt to pull the different threads together. The ideas I have tried to convey have not always been easy to grasp, but if you have followed me attentively, I hope that you will have been able to understand some of the very difficult material that I have been attempting to communicate to you. It has surprised me and also given me great pleasure to see that you have persevered with this course, and that so many of you have kept coming right to the end. I am very well aware that the questions that I have been exploring here are not capable of being readily converted into examination questions, and consequently that you have shown your interest with that disinterestedness that Kant praised so highly. I should like to express my sincere gratitude to you all for this. I wish you all a good vacation and hope that many of you will return next term, when I intend, in a sense, to offer a sort of continuation of this course by lecturing on a different aspect of my little work in progress. I am thinking here of my discussion of the concept of metaphysics. I shall try both to tell you about the concept of metaphysics and the problems arising from it, and also to link this up with the metaphysical theses that I have been pondering for some time now. Thank you all for having been such attentive listeners.